My favourite doctor, well, I'm torn here. Because, I suppose my favourite doctor would be the one I grew up with, which would be Patrick Troughton, really. I thought that David Tennant was amazing, of course, for family reasons. But, I thought that Patrick had that sort of brilliant quality. He also had the most difficult job, because he took over. He was the first regeneration. No one had had the idea of regenerating a doctor before. So for the audience, it was a huge shock to suddenly see William Hartnell dissolve into Patrick, and he did such an amazing job. I remember sitting down and watching it and being prepared to hate Patrick Troughton, but by the end of his first episode, I just thought he was amazing. So I'd say probably Patrick. For many episodes, it was Earth Shock. I liked Eric Saywood. He was a script editor. I thought his writing was particularly good, but I suppose in the end, it was eclipsed by Caves of Androzani, which was a Robert Holmes story. So it was a really classic piece of Doctor Who writing. And we had a brilliant cast, and we had a great director. Apart from the last 30 seconds when I turned into Colin Baker, I would say that was my favourite story. My favourite thing, not many costume changes. Only for Black Orchid, really. There are so many favourite things. You know, you're playing... I was the first actor who played the part who grew up watching it. And so to play that character was an amazing... It was an offer I couldn't refuse. And I suppose, in a way, the thing I liked most was when we would go around filming. You know, wherever we were, in the middle of a town or in the middle of a village, and we would put that TARDIS up, and it would just draw crowds wherever it was put, because at that time, you got the occasional police box, but they were dying out. There was only, I think there was one on the Hendon bypass, I think, but that got taken down while we were filming. So these had suddenly become a rarity, and the moment that, so it's now a completely Doctor Who almost iconic a figure for anyone who's young, and they don't even know what a police box is. But we would just put that set up, the TARDIS set, and it would just attract crowds. And you felt like, really, something special. So it was a great time. It was hard work. It was always made in a state of chaos. We were always chasing the clock because they never gave us enough time. And about a couple of years ago, I went down to watch the filming of Doctor Who Now, because, of course, Now it looks wonderfully glossy and the special effects are amazing. And I went down to Cardiff and it's still made in a state of absolute chaos. People are running around, beating their heads against the wall, the clock is ticking around. And so I was quite gratified to see that hasn't changed. When we went to Lanzarote, because it's a brilliant place, you know, it's a volcanic island, there's no vegetation, no insects. There's a volcanic park, which looks just like, you know, dried lava, and you can go up and you can drive over it. You take a camel trek over it, and we tried to film on it. And what we didn't quite realise is that it's because it's a volcanic park, it's protected, and it's almost deserted up there most of the time when we were there. And we tried to film on it, and you're not meant to go onto the volcanic bit, and we did. And literally, out of nowhere, two police cars appeared and nearly arrested us. But it is a staggering view, again. It is an alien, like an alien landscape. We didn't really make the most of it, because we didn't bother to bring any track with us, which meant we couldn't move the camera, which means you couldn't really get the proper perspective and see that changing. But nevertheless, it's a weirdly beautiful place, I think. Well, I had a great fondness for the Cybermen, if you like to call it fondness. And I thought that the reincarnation of the Cybermen during my time were pretty cool, actually, because they had these sort of perspex chin pieces and you could just see their mouths moving behind there. But I'd always liked them since the early days. I know the classic answer would be the Daleks. They're fantastic, but I don't know, there's something about the Cybermen looked like they could move quickly and could climb stairs and stuff like that. So I always thought they were pretty cool. I suppose the other answer, of course, is the Master. And with all due respect to Anthony Ainley, who did a brilliant job in my time, the classic master going back to my childhood was Roger Delgado. He was the original master, and he was fantastic. I always thought, actually, he would have made a good doctor. I thought maybe they could flip him to the, you know, the light side, as it were.
If you could choose any actor to be the next doctor, who would you pick?
Oh, lordy, 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 lordy. When the series, this, I can't think who I would choose, actually, at this moment in time. I know that when the series was off the air, after Sylvester had done it, and people asked me, I thought that David Warner would be a brilliant a doctor. I mean, he's getting on a bit now, sadly, so he probably wouldn't want to do it. He just wants to sit on the sofa and do the odd radio thing. But I thought he would have made an amazing doctor. I don't know, really. I don't know. I get myself into trouble every time I try and answer this question. Because people inevitably say, how about a woman? I don't know. What I think is, regardless of who they choose, they should just be looking for the best person, male, female, you know, whatever persuasion you want, to play the doctor, rather than going, let's have this, let's have that. I wouldn't like to say, I couldn't. I'll think on it. Ask me again tomorrow. Going back to this question about who would be the next doctor, and, you know, the eternal question, will the next doctor be another woman? My answer has always been, there is a Time Lord out there floating around the galaxy whose name is Jenny, and why don't they bring her back? Let's give her a series. She's off at the moment producing a film, but she can forget that producing stuff. Let's get her back as Jenny. I think it would be great. I think she, you know, that was the reason that she didn't die in the end of that episode. I think in the original script, the end of the Doctor's Daughter, she was meant to die in it. And a memo came from, I think, Stephen Moffat, actually, who hadn't quite taken over yet, but was about to. And he just basically said, don't kill Jenny. Let her go off. So there must have been some plan in the offing that it hasn't come to realisation. But I think it would be a great idea, yeah. You should start a campaign.
Would you consider doing a sequel to The Five-ish Doctors for their 60th anniversary?
Yes, I would love to consider doing a sequel to The Five-ish Doctors. I just need to think of an idea that isn't almost as good. I've had a few ideas knocking around in my head, but whether I'll ever get around to doing them, or whether I can do them given what the idea is, I just don't know. But I wouldn't embark on it unless I thought potentially it could be it could match the Five-ish Doctors reboot. How I would manage to do it without paying anyone any money, because it was the 50th anniversary, everyone did it for nothing. I don't think they'd do it for nothing again.
The brilliant character of Dr. Stephen Dacre, who I think actually was supposed to come from Wolverhampton. What was the inspiration for that brilliant comic performance?
I was very happy to be in the middle of a bunch of crazy people. I was very aware that you know, I was surrounded. I was the point of contact for the audience, really. The audience's reaction was seen through me. And I just thought it was a brilliantly written series. It was Andrew Davis. It was one of the few things that he's an original piece that he's written for television. And interestingly, it came about because he owed the BBC 17,000 quid. Because he'd been commissioned to write an adaptation. I can't remember what it was now. He told me, but he'd been commissioned to write an adaptation of a famous novel. And they paid him ahead of time, £17,000. And he worked for 6 months on it, and then he went back to the BBC and said, this is absolutely appalling, I can't adapt this at all. And the BBC said, fine, could we have our 17,000 quid back? And of course, he'd spent it. So instead he sat down and he wrote A Very Peculiar Practice. You know, at the time he was a lecturer in a university, Warwick University, not far from here. And he put in the character of, I think, Ron Rust in episode 5. who was a writer at the university who owed the BBC 17,000 quid. So it was a brilliant piece of adaptation, really. So, yeah, but it was a great piece of writing. I was very happy to do it.
Is it like working with Imelda, and would you do another musical?
I would do another musical as long as I didn't have that much to do in it. I mean, the great thing, my niche in musicals are, I think, maximum two numbers and a little bit of acting as well. And Gypsy was perfect because, it's one of the great American musicals. This is a musical I did in the West End of London last year. Imelda was amazing. I mean, she was terrifying. I have to say she was terrifying because I hadn't been involved in the production in Chichester. Kevin Whateley had played my part there, and they recast it for the West End. And they all knew what they were doing, and I had no idea what I was doing. And she doesn't hold back, Imelda. You know, she'll just say, I think you should do this, or do this. I think this would be better. And when you get to know her, she's wonderful. She has an amazing, wonderful sense of humour, and we had, a really good relationship. She would mock me all the time, really, which wasn't hard. But and I just used to sit. There's one point I used to just sit off stage in an armchair that was part of the set, and I would just watch Imelda on the stage, just this extraordinary energy that she has. And even when she wasn't on the stage, she would be at the side of the stage looking at what was going on stage and going, I must have a word with them about that. That's not quite right. So it was a great experience. And I'm very, very shocked that she's doing another job now and I'm not in it. What's going on? Anyway, it was wonderful. It was great.
You were doing the autobiography. Was there anything that you kind of you wrote down and you remembered when you're writing it? That you suddenly thought, God, I haven't thought about that in a while.
Yeah, everything, virtually everything. It's amazing thing to do, even if it's only for. I would urge everyone as they get older to try and do it. Not necessarily to publish, but just to write for their children and their grandchildren. You know, some kind of history of your life. I found a bit of a diary my father had kept during the war. And that was just amazing to find it. But what you find when you sit down and you rack your brains about something that you can remember barely anything about, literally 24 hours, 48 hours later, memories will pop into your head. Everything is in there somewhere, and it's just a matter of wheedling it out of and getting it down on paper. So, yeah, it was a voyage of rediscovery, I suppose. But I wrote it all myself because I didn't think anyone else would quite, you know, could quite translate if I just talked to them what I was saying onto the page. So it was a very long and laborious process, but I was determined to write every word myself.